Welcome to What a Friend Friday, a ministry of Maryville Baptist Church. I hate to inform you, but Wesley is out sick today, and I am here filling in. And we're going to hear some good stuff from Brother Josh today. The title is, When God Does What God Hates.
All right, let's go to Romans chapter number 5. You remember we've been talking about now for several months about some of the fundamentals of the faith. We live in a generation and time where people are knocking the fundamentals. They're knocking fundamentalists. But I want to look at the doctrine, and I believe doctrine is very important. It's vital. In our generation, we're going to look a little bit at the doctrine of justification today. And I'd like to look at it with a little bit of twist, maybe a little bit of wordplay, but I want you to pay close attention to the Word of God. I do not want you to misunderstand me whatsoever. Last week, we looked at the idea of condemnation, that man, without question, has been declared condemned. And because he is condemned, he's a sinner by nature. He's condemned to die and go to a place called hell. And I would like maybe for just the next few minutes to look at Romans chapter number 5. We'll use this maybe as a launching place to maybe glean something from the Word of God today. Romans chapter number 5 and verse number 9, it reads like this: Much more then, being now justified by His blood, we shall be saved from wrath through Him. If you've ever wondered if there's ever a place in the Bible you can read and just get excited every time you read it, I can take you to a couple places in the book of Romans that without question, every time you read those verses, excitement ought to swell up inside of you. And we're going to look at a couple of those today. But the Bible says that you and I are now justified by the blood of Jesus Christ. That idea of justification is a legal act of God by which He declares the sinner righteous on the basis of his relationship with Jesus Christ and His finished work. It's simply put many times like this. The definition of justification is just as if I had never sinned. And if it's just as if you never sinned, I've heard some preachers and other commentators put it this way: it's just as if you were never a sinner. It's our sin that makes us a sinner, but you've got to understand this: we sin because we are a sinner. So don't get that confused, that we're sinners by nature, therefore we're condemned, we need justification, we need this great Bible doctrine to take place in our heart and in our life. The idea of justification is the antithesis of condemnation. It's the exact opposite. You and I were condemned, but now we're justified. The idea of you and I being saved It's just as if we'd never sinned. Jesus Christ, the blood of Jesus Christ, paid our eternal sin debt, past, present, and future. All our sins are now under the blood of Jesus Christ. That's what causes you and I to be justified. But I would like to look at it, and I want you to notice something with me just a little bit. I'll pick just a couple of verses. Proverbs chapter 17, we'll look at this verse. The Bible says, Solomon writes in chapter 17 and verse 15, he says, "He that justifieth the wicked and he that condemneth the just, even they both are an abomination to the Lord." Now let's look at that again. It says, "He that justifieth the wicked, he that condemneth the just, even they both are an abomination to the Lord." But then you'll notice what God does. God does this. Romans chapter number 8, one of those verses where you can get excited every time you read it. Romans chapter number 8 and verse number 1, the Bible says, "There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit." Same chapter, if you skip down to verse 33, it says this, "Who shall lay anything to the charge of God's elect? It's God that justifies." So God's the one that's doing the justifying, yet we look back in the book of Proverbs, and Solomon says it's an abomination to the Lord. An abomination to the Lord, he that justifieth the wicked, and he that condemneth the just. And you look at that, and we understand. Now, don't go overboard on me here and get out of context. We understand the context. The generation in which we live in, so often we find that our generation, whether it be from our government or whether it be from a courtroom or just day-to-day life, we find so many times that the wicked are justified. Listen, you need to understand that you're a sinner. You're going to die and go to devil's hell because of your sin. No excuses, not because of the way you was brought up, not because you're a product of your environment, not because you had a bad upbringing, not because this happened or that happened in your life. No excuses. Man is condemned based on the fact that he is a sinner. That cannot be justified by any court of law. That cannot be justified. There is no self-justification when it comes to your sin. You are a sinner. You will not be justified by self. The only one that can justify you is an almighty God. And I want you to see this. Paul put it this way in 2 Corinthians chapter number 5. He said, "To wit, that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, and he hath committed unto us the word of reconciliation." Do you understand that our trespasses, our sin, in order for us to be justified, our sin had to be placed on Christ. You see, your sin debt has been paid for. Every single person that's burning in the flames of hell for all eternity right now are there with their sin debt paid in full. They rejected Jesus Christ. That's what causes man to die and go to hell. It's that man rejects Christ. That's why man would die and go to hell. His sin's paid for. His sin has been laid to the charge of God. Do you understand that God himself is the only one? God's the only one. God is the only one that can bring justification into your heart and into your life. You look at it and you say, the idea that God does what God hates, I know it's just a play on words. We know that God loves man. It was God's plan. The Bible says from the foundation of the world that his son was slain, the lamb slain from the foundation of the world. You and I understand that. Don't go overboard thinking something crazy. But we look at the idea and we understand this idea of justification. And I want you to see this. It's a puzzle to think that in the Old Testament and Proverbs, we look at it and we read something like this that says it's an abomination of the Lord to justify the wicked. We find in Romans chapter number 8 that God's the one that does the justifying. He's the one that does it because he's the only one that can do it. But how do we find? We see the puzzle. We see it's laid out plain. But how do we find the solution to that puzzle? Go with me, if you will, Romans chapter number 3. If you don't have your Bible, get it. I want you to see this. I don't want you to think Brother Josh off the wall or crazy or anything like that. The Apostle Paul lays it out very plainly in Romans chapter number 3. I'd like, man, for sake of time, I'm probably not going to read the whole chapter. I'd like to. You take some time, read the chapter so you can find some understanding on this idea of justification. Man starts out condemned. You have to have a starting place. Man is condemned. Secondly, we find that doctrine of justification. The only way for man to ever get to heaven is for man to be justified. His blood, the blood of Jesus Christ, must be applied to a man's heart. Now, I want you to get this. Look with me. Romans chapter number three, in verse number one. The Bible says, what advantage then hath the Jew? Or what profit is there of circumcision? Now get there. I don't have time to expound on every one of these verses. What Apostle Paul's saying is, what good is religion going to do to you? Religion cannot take away your sin. It can't cover your sin. It can't wash your sin away. You must have the blood of Jesus Christ. Verse 2, it says, much every way chiefly because that unto them, the Bible says, were committed the oracles of God. The Bible says, for what if some did not believe? Shall their unbelief make the faith of God without effect? The next statement in verse 4 is, God forbid. What he's saying, and notice this, if you say, well, Brother Josh, I just don't believe it, it does not change the truth. You hear so many people make this statement, well, I don't believe that God's real. I don't believe there's a heaven. I don't believe that there's a hell. It does not matter whether or not you believe it. Your belief does not change the truth. Just because you say, I don't believe in God, does not mean that God does not exist. Just because you say, I don't believe that there's a heaven, I don't believe that there's a hell, does not mean that heaven and hell does not exist. Your belief is no factor in the truth. The truth is still set in stone. The Bible says, for as it is written, it's already written, the truth is already there. So with that thought laid out, I want you to understand this. When it comes to justification, we must understand this, that man has absolutely no hope in the law. Man has absolutely no hope in the law. Look with me. Romans chapter number 3, verse number 19. The Bible says this, now we know that what things soever the law saith, it saith to them that are under the law. And every mouth may be stopped, and all the world may become guilty before God. What's the purpose of the law? The purpose of the law is to show man that he's a sinner. That's what it's there for. You must be shown, we dealt with it last week, that you are condemned. Man is a sinner. Man is condemned. The purpose of the law is to show man he's condemned. Man sees himself as a sinner. Man recognizes the fact that he's condemned. He then can realize that he needs a Savior. Look at verse 20. The Bible says, therefore, by the deeds of the law, there shall no flesh be justified in his sight. For by the law is the knowledge of sin. We see without question, there's absolutely no hope in the law. Now skip down a few verses with me. Go with me to verse number 27. Verse 27 says this. It says, where is boasting then? It is excluded. By what law? Of works? Nay, but by the law of faith. Therefore, we conclude that a man is justified by faith without the deeds of the law. Man has no hope in the law. It's very plain. That simply means that your good works will never, ever, ever, ever give you justification. You and I understand sin cannot enter into heaven. You and I understand that very plainly. Sin cannot enter into heaven. That being the case, understand this. Your flesh, a sinful flesh, will never, ever be justified by your works. The law cannot justify you. We see there's no hope in the law. But we also see this. Go back with me in verse 21. We also see this. There's no hope in the law, but grace is available. Look at verse number 21. The Bible says this. But now the righteousness of God without the law is manifested, being witnessed by the law and the prophets, even the righteousness of God, which is by faith of Jesus Christ, unto all and upon all of them that believe, for there is no difference. We need to understand this. Grace is available. How can man be justified? Man is justified by faith. Man is justified by faith. He is not justified by works. Well, you say, well, grace is available. Where does that grace come in? Look with me in verse number 24. Verse number 24 says this, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God hath set forth to be a propitiation through faith in his blood to declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are past through the forbearance of God. Now, I want you to get this. Understand this. Grace is available. No hope in the law. Your works will never, ever, 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 ever justify your flesh. Verse 24 makes that very plain. Apart from works, apart from works, apart from works. Works will never, ever, 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 ever give you any justification. Justification is through the grace of God. Through the grace of God. But you find in verse 25 that it's free. The Bible says freely in verse 25, but it's not cheap. It costs the blood of Jesus Christ. That's what makes all the difference. It's not preached in our generation. We're taught that if we're good people, if we're a good person, that we'll make it, that we'll be okay. But there's no justification in this flesh. There's no justification in this flesh by the works of the flesh. You and I are justified by the blood of Jesus Christ, and His grace is made available. We find this without question. It's a wonderful thing that God is the one, God is the only one that can and will justify mankind. I want you to go back with me into verse number 26, and I want you to see this. I hit this just a moment ago, but maybe in light we can see some clarification. We gave a title to this, When God Does What God Hates. You see, God is the one that is doing the justifying. If we're not careful, we'll take Proverbs chapter 17 out of context. You and I understand the context of Proverbs chapter 17. It's in our personal lives when we try to justify the wickedness that's going on in our lives. That's an abomination to God. God is the one that forgives sins. God is the one that shed His blood that you and I can have our sins placed under, that you and I can have justification. We must understand that God is the only one. God is the only one that can give us any type of justification. Look at this with me in verse 26. It says, to declare, I say, at this time, His righteousness. Now get this, that He might be just, not just. That God, listen, God is just, but it goes farther. It's a little exciting when you think about it, that God is just, but notice this, and the justifier of him which believeth in Jesus. Do you understand what that's saying? That's saying that God has the ability to be just, but He also has the ability to be the justifier, to make it just as if you never, ever sinned. You and I, man, I spent 20 minutes last week, boy, telling you how wicked you and I are, that we're condemned. We've been condemned according to John chapter number 3. We're condemned already. But the Bible says that even though we are condemned, you and I can be justified. One of the greatest things you'll find inside the Word of God is when God declares His righteousness and reveals His grace and makes it available to you and I. Not just understanding our eternal salvation, but God makes that grace available on a daily basis. You see what that does? That leaves no room for boasting. You see what that does? That leaves no room whatsoever for you and I to stand in a place in condemnation of another. You see, Jesus Christ has declared His righteousness, and He's given us, revealed His grace, and made it available for you and I. So no matter what takes place in our lives, you and I have grace available in our life because of this idea of justification. And let me give this to you. I need to move on. Listen, do you understand this is not a new thing? This is not a new thing whatsoever. I want you to understand this. If you read on, man, for sake of time, we don't have time to get into it. But read on in your Bible. Look at Romans chapter number 4. You'll find it's not a new thing. You'll read names like this. You'll find a name like Abraham. You'll find a name like David. And you'll find the Apostle Paul using them as illustrations of justification. Jesus Christ the righteous has taken His righteousness and applied it to your life. So it's as if you and I have never sinned. I want you to understand this today. The grace of God is available for your life. The grace of God is available for your life. You say, well, Brother Josh, how is that possible? It's only possible through the blood of Jesus Christ. It's only possible through God, through God Almighty. Yes, he hates the idea. He hates the idea in Proverbs chapter number 17. He hates the idea for the wicked to be justified. Context there, my, is when you and I, it's personal. It's when you and I, the wickedness in our life is justified under a false pretense. Do you understand? According to Romans chapter 3, God's just. God's the justifier. He's the only one that can ever get impart anyone any type of justification. You'll never make it to heaven. You'll never make it to heaven without the blood of Jesus Christ applied to your heart, applied to your soul, made as a payment for your sin. Do you understand today? You must have Jesus Christ in order for you to ever make it. Let me give you this thought. I'll be finished. We looked at the idea of condemnation. We've scratched the surface on this idea of justification. Justification, I started out this way, Romans chapter number 5. That word there is the word now. You get to Romans chapter number 8, the word there is the word now. You and I are justified right now. If you never have anything to get excited about, you can get excited about the fact of that word now. You don't have to wait to be justified. You're justified now. You don't have to wait till you get to heaven to get justified. You're justified now. You don't have to wait for your condemnation to be gone when you get to heaven. Your condemnation is gone now. You and I have something that we can be excited about and be happy about. So let me ask you this. If that's the case, who do you believe is the most unhappy, most miserable person in all the world? Who is it that is the most miserable and the most unhappy person in all the world? I ask you to join us next week. Next week, I'm going to spend some time, take the Word of God, and I'll show you the most miserable and the most unhappy person in all the world. If you don't know Jesus Christ today, go out of your way. Go out of your way. He's here to meet you. He loves you. He has a desire to justify your heart and your soul for all eternity. I hope you enjoy this song. We miss Brother Wesley on here this week, but we'll listen to him sing, at least by way of recording. Sing a song entitled, Come and Meet Him for Yourself. I hope you enjoy it.
what a good time it's been here on What a Friend Friday. Glad to hear that we've been justified. And if you have not been justified, I'd go ahead and remind you that you could come meet him for yourself. It's a wonderful thing to be justified. It's wonderful to be under the blood of Jesus. I got a few announcements for you before we sign off today. I want to remind you that July 31st, we're having a prayer breakfast here at Maryville in the Fellowship Hall. Everybody's invited. It's not just a men's prayer breakfast, but it's an everybody thing. Everybody can come. And then after that, at 3 p.m., we're having a still standing choir workshop. We're trying to get better, try to sing better, try to do as much as we can for the Lord, try to bring as much glory as we can to Him as possible. Also, on August 14th, there's a youth rally coming up here at Maryville. We'll have the Orange family here, and that'll be at 6 p.m. on August 14th. Wanted to remind you a few things before we sign off. I hope Brother Wesley gets to feeling better. I don't want to have to fill in for him again because he can't be here, but he'll feel better next week, and hopefully you'll have a better looking moderator, I guess is what his name is, what he's called. But we pray that we've helped you, and pray that you have been justified this morning. If you haven't been, come meet him for yourself. Thank you.